Thank you very much, Professor Ramamurthy and Professor Santosh. It's a great pleasure and a privilege to be speaking at IIT Madras. I'm very grateful that they have partnered with the Infosys Science Foundation for making this lecture possible. I'm going to speak about the Indus civilization, which is something that is very close to my heart because I have done some research on that. So in the course of my lecture, I will draw on my own research, but I will also highlight the work of a large number of scholars who contributed to the way in which we understand the Indus civilization today. It was 5,000 years ago. In Mohenjo-daro, the morning opened like a sleepy lotus flower at the touch of the sun, and the cocks crowed shrill praise to the giver of light. Men and women and children stirred on their charpoys. Now, these are the opening lines of Mulk Raj Anand's A Day in the Life of Maya of Mohenjo-daro. It's a wonderful tale around the life of a little girl who lived and schooled in Mohenjo-daro, whose father was a potter and a trader, someone who took his wares to Harappa on the one hand, and as far as Ur in Mesopotamia on the other. I began with this for two reasons. First, because my own curiosity about things Harappan began with this particular book when it was presented to me. And second, because right at the outset, I wanted to highlight the fact that while the Indus civilization is ancient, and I will speak about the new perspectives that we have about it, it is also part of our modern world. The story of Mulk Raj Anand represents one way in which the ancient Indus civilization has been intricately woven into the stories and the literature of India. So my lecture on the Indus civilization will be in two parts. First, the civilization, as you know, was discovered in 1924. But there has been much that has been done since then, and I want to give you a sense of how our present knowledge of some aspects of that civilization has changed. In the second part of the lecture, I thought I would simultaneously highlight what the American poet Wallace Stevenson said in general about history. Stevens famously said, I quote, "All history is modern history." And in doing so, he was trying to draw attention to the fact that while there's a reality out there, there are actually specific historical conditions which influence what we make of that reality. So in other words, when we look at the Indus civilization, we learn as much about ancient India as we do about how its history has been reconstructed in modern times. But first, to give you a sense of how the civilization appears today. It is nearly 90 years since the Indus civilization was discovered. On September 20th, 1924, it will be exactly 90 years. And what is worth remembering is that our horizons about it have expanded very considerably. To begin with, if you just look at its geographical spread, in the first phase of research, the Indus civilization was very much a Punjab and Sindh phenomenon with a marginal presence in Balochistan and Gujarat. Today, however, we recognize it as the most ancient and largest urban culture of its time. It covered more than 1 million square kilometers, including not just Sindh and Pakistan Punjab, where Harappa is, but Indian Punjab, Haryana, parts of Uttar Pradesh, all parts of Gujarat as well and Rajasthan, with even a trading post in Afghanistan, northeastern Afghanistan, where the cursor is, at Shotugai. Shotugai in northeastern Afghanistan is entirely Harappan. If you look at its pottery, if you look at the seals, if you look at the mud bricks, there's nothing local about it. So my own sense is that Shotugai actually represents perhaps the earliest Indian diaspora, a group of people who settled in a far-off land even while they maintained very strong links with their homeland. The links of the Indus civilization with regions beyond the Indian subcontinent, I think it's worth remembering, were crucial for all kinds of reasons, but especially for initially dating this civilization. Initially, when we talked about a 2600 BCE date for this civilization, it was based on the presence of etched carnelian beads and long barrel carnelian beads in the royal graves of the South Iraqi city of Ur. The dates of those concerned graves was 2600 BC. So if the Indus civilization was prosperous enough to have been trading with Mesopotamia at that point in time, logically it should have reached a critical level of urbanism before this. Another aspect which is very striking is that whereas earlier our ideas about the civilization were dominated by Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, which remain very important symbols of the civilization, today the picture that we have is far more diverse. We can think of several large urban centers, such as Gameriwala in Cholistan, Rakhi Gadi, which is in Hisar, and Tholaveera, which is in the Kutch area of Gujarat. There are also many types of cities. When we think of Mohenjo-daro, we think of a city which was in two parts. The western part of the city, which was a largely public and ritual area, and the larger but more or less private residential eastern sector. On the other hand, today we also know that there was a city like Dholaveera, which has revealed a town plan that is unparalleled and is in three parts. R.S. Bish of the Archaeological Survey of India has demonstrated that at Dholaveera, the citadel itself was divided into two parts, what he has called the castle, this fortified section, and the Bailey, which was the administrative center, the middle town, and then the lower town. And as you can see, all of them were really interlinked within a very elaborate system of fortification. At Dholaveera, there are gateways, and associated with these gateways were ceremonial pathways, guard chambers, and as you can see in the second slide, the remains of stone pillars in the castle section, which actually had not been found in any other Indus city. There was also a formidable arrangement for water. Mohenjo-daro had wells, a very large number of wells. The estimate is that it could be as many as 900 wells. Whereas at Dholaveera, the two local streams, Manhar and Mansar, were actually integrated into the overall civic planning. The city has been made in a way that it could harvest this water. Apart from this, there were multiple reservoirs at Dholaveera as well, apparently 16 of them meant for storing rainwater and water from rivulets, which used to be dammed and then taken into the reservoirs. Finally, Dholaveera can boast of the first public hoarding of the Bronze Age world. It's an inscription of 10 letters which was found in front of, on the ground of the Western Chamber in the North Gate. Usually when we think of Indus inscriptions, we think of very tiny inscriptions on seals and amulets and so on. But in this case, each of these letters is 37 centimeters in height, and it's, you know, these are made out of a white crystalline material. Obviously, at that point in time, they were fixed on a wooden board, but of course that wood has not survived, but the letters have survived. Now, this was the first series of settlements, places like Dholavira, Rakhigarhi, Mohenjo-daro, Harappa. Then you had a second series of urban settlements. Kalibanga, for instance, like Mohenjo-daro, has an eastern and a western segment, and both of them are fortified. And like Mohenjo-daro, a large part of the western mound of Kalibanga, this part is dominated by public structures, including what is considered to be a number of fire altars. These fire altars can only be used facing the east. Now, what settlements like this reveal is that there is actually no necessary relationship between the size of an urban center and urban planning. So, for example, if you look at Lothal, Mohenjo-daro was at least 25 times the size of Lothal. But Lothal shares with Mohenjo-daro a very careful planning of burnt brick houses, a very well laid out alignment of drains, of streets. It's the only urban center of the Harappan civilization whose streets and lanes were all paved, paved with mud bricks and covered by a layer of kankar. Below urban centers like Lothal and Kalibanga, there were still smaller commercial centers. One of these is in Muzaffarnagar district. Muzaffarnagar has been in the news for all the wrong reasons, but Muzaffarnagar also had a number of Harappan sites, and one of these is the site of Mandi. Now, as you can see from the inset, it's really a very humble and unprepossessing site. And the excavators believe that not more than 150 people could actually have lived there. But Mandi has yielded kilos of gold, silver, and hoards of semi-precious stones. So obviously it was a commercial center of some significance. Now, below this urban hierarchy, you of course had a large number of rural settlements, which haven't been studied as carefully as urban settlements. But what we do know is that there were a large number of villages, but along with villages, there were also many temporary semi-nomadic sites. Some of these have been excavated in areas like Cholistan in Pakistan and in Gujarat. Now, if our ideas about the Indus civilization's urban centers have changed, so have our ideas about their food pattern. Earlier, we used to think of Indus subsistence being largely around the cultivation of wheat and barley. Today, we know that the Indus civilization had a much more diverse agricultural geography in which actually millet and rice were quite important. Rice has been found in Harappa in Punjab, at Balu in Haryana, and at Lothal in Gujarat. And interestingly enough, none of these areas actually are marked by a long tradition of rice cultivation. On the other hand, in India, rice has a very long tradition of cultivation in the central Ganga plains. at Lahura Deva, which was excavated by Dr. Rakesh Tiwari, as early as 6000 BCE, people were cultivating rice. This is the kind of evidence that he's found. You're not just looking at rice grains, you're looking at a lot of rice husk, which was mixed up with the clay for making pots and thatches and so on and so forth. Now, knowledge of rice cultivation, my own sense is, came from the east to the Indus civilization area. So in other words, when we think of the Indus, we no longer think of it as living in a kind of civilizational autarky, dominating everything around it. On the contrary, something as basic as its food was in important ways influenced by its contacts with contemporary cultures. And such cultures, I think I should point out, were not just agricultural societies. Hunter-gatherers too were a part of the Indus civilization's contact zone. I'm saying this because if you look at the animals which were consumed by the Harappans, of course, cattle and goat are very important, but so are, megafauna, including rhino and elephant. There's lots of fish, there are birds, there are mollusks. So the question that then arises is that how did the Harappans procure these wild species? And it's a very large percentage. 1:4 is the percentage of the wild species as compared to the domesticated fauna. So it's much higher than what you see, let's say, in historic India. Were the communities then within the Indus civilization hunting animals, or did they depend upon contemporary hunter-gatherers? Actually, I think it was probably both. If you including very large animals like the elephant and the tiger, I mean, look at this representation of the tiger. It captures the predatory character of the animal. So you get a sense that, these sorts of representations were based on a very intimate knowledge of these animals. But along with this, there was also a close interaction with hunter-gatherers. One example which comes to mind is a hunter-gatherer site in Gujarat called Langnaj. It's a specialized hunter-gatherer site, which is a contemporary of the Indus civilization. So along with all the stone tools, it has yielded a pure copper knife. It has yielded pottery, which is similar to Harappan pottery, and it has yielded Harappan disc beads. Most importantly, the hunter-gatherers at Langnaj had very bad teeth. The percentage of dental caries in Langnaj was about 8%, whereas the average percentage for hunter-gatherers living at that technological level is normally between 4 to 4.8%. So obviously they were consuming agricultural foodstuff, and cereals must have come to them from the Harappans. Now, if all these things were coming to the hunter-gatherers, surely they in turn were providing something to the Harappans. And my sense is that they may well have provided wild animals, which the Harappans so enjoyed, whose flavors the Harappans enjoyed very much. Then our understanding of Indus craft and trade has also expanded considerably from the first phase of Indus research. Now, one of the most striking things of craft production that we realize today is that it was actually not confined to areas where the raw materials are found. So for example, if you look at shell artifact manufacture, there are craft centers like Bagasra, which are actually close to the sources of shell. But at the same time, shell objects were also manufactured at places like Channudaro and Mohenjo-daro, which are actually very far from marine shell sources. At Mohenjo-daro, shell objects were manufactured out of Turbinella pyrum, which comes from the coast of Sindh and Balochistan. Turbinella pyrum shells were brought in a raw state to the city. The marine organisms were removed, and then the shell was cleaned for further processing. So the point I'm trying to make is that this kind of craft could only survive and prosper because of a very well-organized system of trade. The Harappans, in fact, had the capacity to mobilize all kinds of resources, especially semi-precious stones. You find Harappan sites in all kinds of places yielding large quantities of such beads, as you can see on the monitor. And some of these beads are also made out of lapis lazuli, which would have come from Shotugai in Afghanistan. But apart from this, ordinary stone was also taken very far away from the source where it was found. I owe this slide to Dr. Prabhakar of the Archaeological Survey of India. It shows a particular kind of stone which comes from Kaliana Hills in the Bhiwani district of Haryana. But you find objects manufactured out of this stone both in Rajasthan and as far as Harappa in Pakistan, Punjab. Apart from this, there was a trade in food items. This is very well underlined by the presence of marine catfish, which has been found at Harappa, that is hundreds of kilometers from the sea. So just as today, you know, we like to consume very exotic foods, the Harappans were also very shocking from, you know, this perspective. Craft items were traded as well. Take the case of these shell ladles. A large number of shell ladles have been found at Mohenjo-daro. But the manufacturing evidence for shell ladles does not exist there. On the other hand, the manufacture of such ladles is one of the most important industries at the coastal Harappan site of Nageshwar in Gujarat. So it's likely that Nageshwar was actually providing these ladles to Mohenjo-daro. In much the same way, shirt blades from the Rohri Hills of Sindh reached Harappa on the one hand and Lothal on the other. So whichever way we look at it, there's a sense, I think, that in the last 90 years or so, our understanding of the Harappan civilization has actually grown and consolidated in many important ways. Having said that, of course, I want to add that some of our ideas about it, and I'll end this part of my lecture here, have remained the same. I'm thinking, for example, of our ideas of Indus religion. If you look at the first excavation report of Mohenjo-daro, which was published in 1931, John Marshall described Indus religion as being indicative of what he called were later Hindu practices. So, you know, he said that these later became Hindu ways, a part of the Hindu way of life. Even today, many would have no hesitation at all in arguing that some of the major elements of later Indian religions can be traced back to the Indus, especially its devotional aspects such as goddess worship, tree worship, the idea of sacrifice, even the existence of a phallic proto-Shiva-like deity. And in this context, the most important find has actually come from Kalibanga. It's a very small, it's a miniature terracotta linga, which was set in what looks like a Gauripatta, and it's astonishingly close, not in its size, but in its form, to a modern Shivalinga. This is only a single find, but if you take all the evidence together, I think there's little doubt that the prehistory of later day Hinduism can actually be traced back to the Indus civilization. And here, I then come back to Mulk Raj Anand. Among the most important religious structures of the Indus civilization is the Great Bath of Mohenjo-daro. But how it was used really depends upon the gaze that a scholar or an observer brings to bear on it. On the one hand, there are those who have suggested that the Great Bath was connected to cultic bathing, because there are actually three concentric zones around it, including streets on all four sides of the Great Bath, obviously made for the purpose of facilitating the movement of a ritual procession into it. But on the other hand, Mulk Raj Anand maintained that it was a people's bathing area for those who did not have big bathrooms in their houses. So he actually saw the Great Bath as a facility for the poor, a meeting place, as he put it, for people. So when it comes to interpretation, I think every person is her or his own archaeologist. And therefore, when I'm asked that, well, how does the Indus civilization appear 5,000 years after its demise? My answer is always that the image that you have of the Indus civilization is really as much a product of people's ideas and ideologies as it is a product of the ruins that have emerged out of places like Mohenjo-daro and Dholavira. To now move on to the second part of this lecture, the link between the ancient and the modern. Like much of ancient India, was rediscovered in modern times. So the first question which we need to answer is, why did it take so long to discover it? After all, do remember that Harappa was first noticed in the 19th century when British military men surveying places of archaeological importance described it in publications. People like Charles Masson, for example, who published the first English language account where Harappa figures. He provided an account of Harappa's impressive mounds, and what he did also was to seek out the history of Harappa from the classical accounts of the invasions of Alexander the Great. For him, Harappa was the fortress of Sangala, described in the account of the Greek philosopher-historian Arrian. Incidentally, the archaeologist Alexander Cunningham, who first excavated Harappa, 40 years after Masson had visited it, also visualized the city in a similar textual way. Cunningham is generally described as the father of Indian archaeology, if it had a father. And this is because, above all, he gave literary descriptions of ancient India, especially those of the Chinese pilgrims, Fa Hian and Xuan Sang, a grassroots reality. So if you look at Cunningham's survey of Harappa, he gives a narrative description of the mounds, but he also provides a site plan, this plan which you see, which graphically illustrates the alignment of the mounds. And he provides visual details of objects that we today consider as archetypal objects of the Indus civilization. This includes, as you can see, an inscribed seal and these long flint implements. Now, these were aberrations in the sense that such artifacts Cunningham had not encountered, as he himself tells us, at the sites which he had surveyed for decades in the Indian subcontinent. But when it came to identifying Harappa, he fell back on literary descriptions. He identified Harappa as Po Fa To Lo, a place where Xuanzang is supposed to have stayed for several months. So the point I'm really trying to make is that there wasn't an Indus civilization which lay buried at Harappa, whose antiquity was self-evident to anybody who came there and surveyed the place. Travelers like Masson and archaeologists like Cunningham came there but failed to understand Harappa's significance because of the textual grids they worked with. Harappa, after all, had flourished in an age which was beyond such textual traditions. And obviously, its antiquity was unlikely to be discovered by those who were either in the company of Chinese pilgrims or who, you know, spent their time with Alexander and Northwest India. So how was the Indus civilization eventually discovered? There was actually no great improvement in the precision of knowledge of the Indian past from which this then emerged. All that we have is that for a couple of decades before 1924, there were aberrations, anomalies which did not actually fit in with the then dominant framework of Indian history. These areas of anomaly had to be properly explored and conceptually assimilated, which required not an adjustment of the old paradigm, but the creation of a substantially different paradigm. Now, the dominant historical paradigm, even in 1924, was an invasion-immigration framework, which is very well summed up in the first volume of the Cambridge History of India. I'm quoting from that volume. It said, "Thus have foreign races and foreign civilizations been brought into India, the history of which, in a large measure, is the story of the struggle between newcomers and earlier inhabitants." Now, there's no way in which what emerged from Mohenjo-daro and Harappa could actually be accommodated within this invasion-immigration framework. A new way of looking at the past was needed to account for it. And this eventually happened in 1924, when the discovery of the Indus civilization was announced. It is in fact not fortuitous that the archaeologist who presided over the discovery of the Indus civilization, John Marshall, he was the Director General of the ASI, from the early 1900s, was the only scholar who imagined that there was actually an unknown archaeological canvas which preceded what was then considered to be the beginning of the subcontinent's historical past. And this is because he had encountered data which actually didn't fit in with the prevalent view of early India. We know, for instance, that even before he came to India in 1901, he had seen the seals of Harappa in the British Museum, and he remembered that they actually really intrigued him. So in 1903, he deputed Hiranand Shastri, a pundit in charge in the archaeological office in Punjab, to survey sites in the Ganga Yamuna Doab, which he believed would yield objects that would belong to the age of bronze. And this is 1903, and he says in his correspondence that such a bronze age, he thought, could be correlated with the early Vedic age. Now, as it so happened, nothing was unearthed by Hiranand which would allow Marshall to substantiate this connection. And it was only in 1924 that the idea of a literate Bronze Age was firmly established in the Indian subcontinent. But the point I'm trying to make is that as early as 1903, the prism through which Marshall viewed the Indian past was already one that accommodated such a notion. You know, this it's a complete fallacy to think that you go out in the field and discover great things. You do that, of course, but first of all, you have to have the imagination, the willingness to look beyond what is there as the given truth. And I think this was there in Marshall right from the early part of the 20th century. In the same year, that is 1903, other clues from a place called Null, which is in Baluchistan, were unearthed by Hughes Buller. Hughes Buller is remembered as the compilator of the Baluchistan District Gazetteers, but he also saw himself as a kind of amateur archaeologist, and he used to make it his business to visit and make collections from old mounds. Now, much of the time, he could not establish the antiquity of the artifacts that he came up with, so he used to correspond with various people. In 1903, he wrote to John Marshall about polychrome bowls, like you see here, that a member of his staff, Mirza Sher Mohammad, had found at Nal. When photographs of this pottery reached Marshall, he immediately declared that if other objects were discovered, there was a very real possibility of the history of the Northwest going back by several millennia. This intuition of Marshall has proved to be correct. Null is today recognized as being part of the background to the birth of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa. So it's even older than what Marshall imagined it to be. In fact, after the announcement of the discovery of the Indus civilization in 1924, Marshall would himself depute one of his officers to excavate Null. He would have taken this decision to get Null opened up because of the glimpse that he had of its pottery more than 20 years ago in the autumn of 1903. So what I'm trying to say is that John Marshall's teething years saw the discovery of objects which he considered as being unrepresented in the narrative of ancient India. Having said that, though, it should also be mentioned that he actually never followed up these clues for various reasons. Harappa, for instance, for all his interest in its seals, was excavated only in 1921. Even though serious thinking about excavating it began in 1908. We know this because in 1908, the district commissioner of Montgomery wrote to John Marshall that the mounds of Harappa could be purchased from the owners for a sum of a little less than 5,000 rupees. Now, considering that in 1903, the same sum of money was spent on excavations all over India, this would have seemed like a very large sum of money. So before finalizing the purchase, Marshall wanted some kind of feasibility report prepared. In the next few years, he actually sent three archaeologists on different occasions to check out Harappa. The third report was of Harold Hargreaves in 1914, who recommended excavations there, even though he was unimpressed with the mounds. What is also important about Hargreaves' report is that it contains the first photographs of Harappa. So for the first time, Marshall and people in the archaeological survey could see what the high rolling mounds looked like and also get a sense of the kinds of objects that were still being found in Harappa, not just seals, but also what we today recognize to be Chalcolithic ring stones, which are in front of Anauga's shrine in that city. All this is captured in those photographs. But again, the excavations did not take place. And there's a reason for this. In 1914, the Great War, which we call World War I today, broke out. And among other things, there was a massive war effort on the part of British India, which resulted in all kinds of cutbacks. So there was a moratorium, for example, on new excavations. And that is why the excavations of Harappa could not take place. Eventually, Harappa was excavated by Dayaram Sahni on John Marshall's instructions. And it was this 1921 excavation which led to a realization that the Harappa seals belonged to a phase that most certainly antedated the time of the Mauryas and would actually probably go back to 1000 BC. But more than Harappa, it was the seals which unexpectedly emerged from Mohenjo-daro which would be crucial in a realization that this was not a unique site that we were looking at, but it was a new, unique culture that was being discovered. In the case of Mohenjo-daro, there was actually no prior understanding that the excavations would yield any kind of novel or dramatic evidence. When Rakhal Das Banerjee, who got himself officially photographed, this is in the albums of the ASI, holding a pot from Mohenjo-daro, when he headed to excavate it in December 1922, he actually went to excavate Buddhist Mohenjo-daro, especially the stupa, this stupa that you see here, which crowned what we today recognize as the citadel mound of the ancient city. It just so happened that unexpectedly, one of his assistants made the momentous discovery of two inscribed seals in this area, which is just below the platform of the stupa mound. Banerjee immediately realized that they were inscribed with characters that were identical to those on the seals of Harappa, of the kind that Cunningham had first published. This was an amazing discovery because Mohenjo-daro was several hundred kilometers to the southwest of Harappa. So it certainly meant that Harappa was not a unique site, but what was being revealed was a distinctive culture. This was brought to the attention of John Marshall in March 1923. Marshall was very enthusiastic, but he could not do much immediately because he was leaving for England on long leave. More surprisingly, on his return to India in December, he did not visit either Mohenjo-daro or Harappa, where excavations had actually resumed on his orders. Instead, he proceeded to Taxila, the city which he excavated for more than two decades. However, at the close of the second season at Mohenjo-daro, one of his officers, Madhav Swarup Vats, wrote to him about the other similarities which were turning up from both the sites. He pointed out that it was not just a question of identical seals, but there were identical bricks that were used in the buildings, clay bangles were the same, you had the same sort of sling balls, and even a kindred terracotta art. This was in April 1924, more than a year after the seals had been discovered at Mohenjo-daro. It was that summer, after receiving Vats's letter, that John Marshall finally broke routine to begin coming to grips with the enigma of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa. And how did he do this? He did it by getting the excavated collections from both sides and all the concerned officers in June 1924 to his head office in Shimla. So when people ask me where was the Indus civilization discovered, I always say that it was discovered in Shimla, because John Marshall actually had not visited either Harappa or Mohenjo-daro, and working out the significance of the civilization and the sites themselves happened very far away from either Punjab or Sindh. This, of course, must truly have been the most exciting archaeological examination in the lives of those archaeologists, because as they saw all this material spread out before them, the overarching archaeological identity that Madhav Swarup once had articulated must have been immediately evident. After this, the task ahead was to draw public attention to the distinctive character of the civilization. Marshall knew that the first announcement would become a kind of seminal starting point for a new kind of past, one that was actually much more in tune with the ancientness that Indians usually ascribed to their nation. And anyone who has read John Marshall's announcement in the Illustrated London News of September 20th, 1924 would realize that actually his pen did succeed in appropriately projecting the work that had birthed the beginning, a new beginning for India's ancient past. The one point, though, that I want to draw your attention to concerns how he described the discovery. He saw the birth and the character of the Indus civilization as entirely indigenous, not imported from other lands or marked by outside influences. Now, this conclusion of Marshall, as we know today, is correct. But what makes it exceptional is that it was articulated in an era when it was quite the fashion to see the stimulus of high culture in ancient India as emanating from the West. One only has to think of a person like Vincent Smith, who was convinced that the best elements in the plastic, pictorial, numismatic and dramatic arts of ancient India were of Greco-Roman origin. Now, in contrast, you now had a colonial sahib who was announcing that India's most ancient culture was actually a product of the soil of the Indus Valley. In 1924, this is at the time of the national movement, it was also likely to appeal hugely to national sentiment. In fact, it is possible that this may be one of the reasons why Marshall wrote the way he did. The British government that funded his department had drastically reduced the budget of the archaeological survey, and Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa had actually been excavated on a pittance. Publicizing the connection was important to generate pressure on the government, and he believed by writing in this way, it was possible that this very parsimonious government would actually give more money for excavations. And he was not disappointed. In comparison to the 12,000 rupees he had in 1923-24, for the whole of India and Burma, in 1924-25, he was given an extra disbursement of 80,000 rupees. And better was to follow in the following year, a special grant of 2.5 lakhs was made for the exploration and excavation of Harappan cities. So how the first account of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro was written up had a great deal to do with what had been discovered, but equally it was aimed to ensure that nationalist sentiment would force the political establishment of British India to provide money so that the work at Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa could be done on the scale that they deserved. Now, this play of politics and scholarship in the discovery saga of the Indus civilization continued. Perhaps the least known but the most important set of events which concerns independent India's discovery of its Indus past is an excellent example of this. In this case, though, it was not scholars who pressurized politicians, but it was men in high political places who actually proactively pushed Indus research. It's a story that reminds us of the archaeologist Amalananda Ghosh. He was an officer of the ASI. He went on to become the Director General. It was Ghosh who in 1950 actually did an exploration of Bikaner, in the course of which he discovered as many as 15 sites which yielded antiquities of the type that had been found at Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. Now this is well known, but how did Amalananda Ghosh's survey take place? In truth, actually along with Ghosh's contribution, there's another claim to be staked for the uncovering of the Indus civilization in Rajasthan. And the claim belongs not to an archaeologist, but to a scholar administrator, Sardar K.M. Panikkar. Now, the remarkable career of this Kerala-born man is well known. He was a professor at Aligarh Muslim University to begin with in 1919. He then became the founder editor of Hindustan Times. And at the time of partition, K.M. Panikkar was actually the Diwan of Bikaner. And soon after that, he became India's ambassador to China. It was in March 1948, less than a month before he took over as ambassador to China, that Panikkar wrote to Prime Minister Nehru about the necessity of a survey in the desert areas of Bikaner and Jaisalmer. He mentions in his letter that he had met the famous archaeologist Aurel Stein, who himself had worked in Rajputana. Stein had told Panikkar that if his work was carried forward, it was entirely possible to show that the Indus civilization had a very large presence in that tract. So Panikkar was now writing to Nehru to take this scheme forward. Panikkar urged India's Prime Minister to direct the archaeological survey to explore the possibilities of such research. Nehru was very enthusiastic about this proposal. Well, I can say he was very enthusiastic because within a day of receiving Panikkar's note, a letter from his principal private secretary enclosed a copy of this note with a note from Nehru as well to the Minister of Education. And the note said that the Prime Minister entirely agrees with the suggestion contained in the note and hopes that the archaeological department will undertake the exploration suggested in Bikaner and Jaisalmer. Now, this proposal was sent to the Archaeological Survey of India. They suggested that they could do the work if 10,000 rupees was provided for it. The finance ministry, as it still often does, decided to play spoiler. It raised questions, for example, about why a central department should send and spend money on the archaeological fieldwork in a native princely state. And it actually required many missives from Nehru's office to get these reluctant mandarins to eventually open out their purse strings. This would not have been possible if the proposal of Panikkar had not been strongly supported by Nehru himself. So finding forgotten cities in India, which is seen as one of the major achievements of Indian archaeology since 1947, is an accomplishment that owes as much to statesmen who had the vision to push for such research as it does to the discerning archaeologists who actually made these discoveries. Prompted such proactive measures which made the Indus civilization one of the major achievements, the discovery of its sites in independent India, it had very ambiguous consequences for the antiquities of Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. After partition, there were prolonged and complicated negotiations relating to the division of museum collections. And in the case of the Harappan antiquities, the solution that was arrived at was based really on compromise and on equity. That is the reason why The National Museum actually still has such a splendid collection from Mohenjo-daro and Harappa because there was a 50-50 division of these collections. This is actually not a problem, the sharing of antiquities. But what makes this solution of dividing things down 50-50 very problematic is that in searching for a solution which was equitable, what was crucially sacrificed was the integrity of some of the objects themselves. On the suggestion of the recently retired Director General of the ASI then, Mortimer Wheeler, some unique objects were actually also divided down the middle. This included a magnificent Mohenjo-daro necklace made of jade beads, gold discs, and semi-precious stones. This is the original. And one part of it is with India, and another part of it is in Pakistan. They've been divided round the middle. Similarly, this fabulous carnelian and copper girdle that you see of Mohenjo-daro, this was also divided down the middle. Oddly enough, nowhere in the correspondence is there a sense that the character of these objects was being permanently destroyed. Instead, there's just an overriding anxiety to adhere to the arithmetic of division. Now, in conclusion, I just want to say that situations like this actually raise a larger issue about whether equity should be the basis for such divisions. Here, archaeologists and negotiators, in their anxiety to adhere to what they thought was politic, actually, I think, failed to explore more ethical options. I've often wondered, so many decades later, is there a way in which this can be undone? Surely, India and Pakistan can take heed from the experience of two pieces of sculpture, one of which was in the National Gallery of Washington, while the other was in the Louvre in Paris. When the two pieces were revealed to be parts of a single sculpture, Saint Christopher carrying the Christ child with the globe of the world, the National Gallery gave its sculpture on permanent loan to the Louvre. Since 1973, the sculpture has been there on the principle that the aesthetic value of the reunited sculpture is greater than the value of its dismembered parts. The Louvre, in turn, on occasion, has loaned the sculpture to the National Gallery in Washington for display. So with some good faith on both sides, is it possible for the Mohenjo-daro necklace and girdle to be reunited? I don't think this would change the principles on which the pasts of India and Pakistan were partitioned, but it will certainly restore the integrity of these objects. I think such an arrangement would also underline that these form part of the common heritage of both nation states. But whether political rifts can be overcome in order to reunite a fractured heritage is still very much an open question. Thank you. Tessitore, because actually in my book, Finding Forgotten Cities, I have a whole chapter on Tessitore. Now, Tessitore was a pioneer because he actually excavated Kalibanga before Harappa and Mohenjo-daro were excavated. And he found seals there. He also found stone blades there. But Tessitore was by training a linguist. So he didn't understand the significance of what he had found. Now, when all this happened, his mother fell very ill. So Tessitore went to Italy. By the time he reached Udine, where he was from, his mother had died. He stayed on for some months in Italy, and at that point in time, he corresponded with his own mentor, George Grierson, who led the Linguistic Survey of India. He sent him photographs of the Kalibanga seals. Grierson was very enthusiastic, and he says, "I don't understand the writing, but it looks like Chinese." to which, of course, Desideri said that, no, I mean, I vehemently disagree with you. And Grierson then told Desideri that, look, when you go back, please show this material to John Marshall so that you can then take his permission and publish it in the Journal of the Royal Asiatic Society of Great Britain and Ireland, where, in fact, a lot of the people who worked on ancient scripts and languages published. This is exactly what Desideri must have planned to do. However, on his way back to India, he contracted pneumonia, and by the time he came, within a few weeks, he died in Bikaner. And the knowledge of his great discovery also died with him. So he's buried there. I've been to his grave. And I actually discovered this whole story about Desideri because there was a Jain gentleman, a businessman, Hazarimal Bhantia, who was interested in Desideri, not because of the Indus discoveries, but because Desideri had made a major contribution to the Jain vernaculars. So for the Jains, he was a very important figure. Now, Bhantia had actually gone to Italy and got a lot of his old records and papers and letters photocopied. And that was in the Bikaner archives. So he guided me to the Bikaner archives and said that you should look at all this. And that's how the story came out. Because even the archaeological survey of post-independence India, while it excavated Kalibanga, were not aware, forget Marshall, even the post-independence ASI was not aware of the great contribution of this story. I'm very glad you mentioned
it. Thank you.
Good evening, ma'am.
I still think that the evidence of writing in Mesopotamia is earlier than the earliest seals of Harappa. So I really don't see how you can talk about the Indus being the cradle of all civilizations. I also feel that this is a very old style of doing things. Why do we have to look for one cradle? Today, one of the major contributions in whether it's technology or it is looking at the beginning of agriculture or the birth of cities is to see multilineal processes. Even in India, the advent of agriculture in the Northwest around barley, wheat, and the domestication of goat, this is a very different process from the advent of agriculture in the Gangetic Plains, which was rice-based. So I actually feel very happy that there are many stories, that there isn't a singular story. And it is this kind of multilineal heritage which should make us feel very proud. We don't need to take it back to one unitary story to understand everything that has happened in India or beyond India as well.
Hello,
ma'am.
Of a third millennium BC civilization. If you look at the immediate writings that came out in places like newspapers, the Larkana Gazette, and so on and so forth, the sense you get is of people saying that, well, we may be colonized, but on the other hand, we are the heirs to this great heritage. And if the British have any sense of self-respect, they must now recognize us as equals and leave our country. My book, Finding Forgotten Cities, actually, there are two quotations it begins with, and one is from the Larkana Gazette. So I think that connection, which Marshall was talking about, that this is a product of the soil of the Indian subcontinent, it did strike a very strong chord. There was also simultaneously a great anxiety that a lot of this material should not be taken out of India. So if you look at the questions that were asked in the assembly and so on and so forth, there's a lot of anxiety about this. example, you see Nehru being present in ceremonies around his sites and so on and so forth. I haven't seen his presence there in quite the same way at, you know, places of Indus interest. But he's the one who actually